I don't know what you were doing 49 years and 364 days ago, but I was watching TV in my family's living room in Texas as the module landed on the moon. And our speaker today is going to talk about that. He's going to give us a little different angle on it than the one Walter Cronkite gave us back in 1969. And the best part about it is, for a new president, he wrote his own introduction. Mike Simpson needs no introduction here. Like Buzz Aldrin, the former chancellor of the International Space University, with whom Mike is pictured here, Mike knows that Apollo was a stop along the way to learning more about space than we ever dreamed possible. Let's hear Mike tell that story. Please come on up, Mike.
There's my little clicker.
Oh, Fred has your little clicker.
There we go. Thank you. Takes a lot of 5 minutes out of schedule. Okay, great. So every story has a beginning. There's some people that say that the beginning of the Apollo 11 story took place in early ancient Greece when Anaxagoras, a friend of Pericles, risked and then ultimately received exile from Athens for claiming that the moon was a rock like the earth, that it was just another body that could be visited. Given that the thinking at the time was that the moon was a god, this idea did not go over very well. And Anaxagoras spent the rest of his life in a remote part of Greece where he couldn't disturb the minds of young children. From my standpoint, the whole story really began millennia before Anaxagoras. It began when some of our cave-dwelling ancestors looked out on a scene like this and wondered whether they could go there. To a certain extent, throughout the human experience of space, there's been this fascination with what's out in the distance of the night sky. Well, although that may have been the emotional motive for driving people to want to explore space, we know that the political origins of Apollo 11 were much more recent. The political origins were Sputnik. When the Russians launched Sputnik in 1957, it instantly delivered to the American people the message that Russia was a significant engineering power that, unlike the rumor, was perfectly capable of inventing things on its own. Sputnik woke America up to the fact that it was possible to actually orbit something and to pursue the possibility of space travel. It also woke America up to the possibility that the rocket that launched Sputnik could also launch a weapon. And so the space race was on. Just a few years later, 4 years later, we get to the second big story. We've had a new president elected. The president ran on the idea that there was a missile gap with the Russians. Now the Russians have put a human being into orbit and safely brought him back to Earth. A major scientific and engineering accomplishment, but also a military reality. To have brought him back to Earth meant that the Russians had successfully built a heat-shielding system that could protect him on reentry. That same system, of course, could protect a weapon on reentry. The message wasn't lost on the young President Kennedy. And shortly after this event, April 13th, 1961, We see a memorandum from John Kennedy on April 20th, 1961, asking the Vice President of the United States, who was the head of the National Space Council, to find something, anything that was dramatic where the United States could beat the Russians. Because this was a public relations battle, it was also an attempt to let the Russians know that, yes, we had capabilities that might offset theirs, and let's not waste each other's time with a ballistic missile exchange. 6 days after this memorandum, the vice president responded with an 8-page memorandum that included the recommendation that if the United States was willing to invest enough money, it would be able, it would have a reasonable chance of beating the Russians to landing a human being on the moon and safely returning the human being to Earth. Well, Kennedy, who was, by his own admission, not a big space guy, said, let's try. And in fact, just a month later, here he is standing in front of Congress about to deliver one of his most famous speeches.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
What you don't hear there, and you wouldn't have heard if we played the entire speech, was applause. This proposition was greeted with absolute silence on both sides of the political aisle. They were stunned. The idea that it was possible had never occurred to most members of Congress. But Kennedy did not give up the idea. And so here, about 15 months later, Kennedy is in Texas at Rice University, and you're going to see more energy in the speech, but also more energy in the audience.
There is no strife, no prejudice, no national conflict in outer space as yet. Its hazards are hostile to us all. Its conquest deserves the best of all mankind. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. And in fact, we had almost no idea from the beginning of this exercise how hard getting this challenge completed was going to be. In fact, however, Kennedy would never live to see it. Three of the astronauts selected to have been the first ones to go to the moon would die in training and not get to see it. But 7 years after this speech, we did get the chance to see it happen.
Four forward.
These are the four final
forward,
seconds.
Right, and a half. 30 seconds forward.
30 seconds. That's how much fuel they had left.
Contact light. Okay, engine stop. AGA at a descent. Host control, both auto descent, engine command override off. Engine arm off.
We're home.
413 is in.
That's Wally Schirra's voice.
Moon.
Walter Cronkite.
Get down, Eagle. Listen,
oh, jeez.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed. Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
In fact, they were about to turn blue because they knew just how hard this was. Half of what had to be done in the moon landing could not be tested before the moon landing. You couldn't test the lunar module in a vacuum, a vacuum-like space. You couldn't test it against lunar regolith, whose composition we barely understood. That is the soil of the moon. Much of what happened was brand new, and yet it happened. And when it happened, we took a little while to realize just how tough it actually was. I don't know if any of you are private pilots, but this is not what you look for when you are trying to find a runway, and you've got, and yet this is where they landed. So, I don't think there's a light on this, is there? No. Well, so this is the lunar module. This is taken by the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter just a year or two ago. You can actually even see the outline of the Hasselblad camera that was left on the moon so they could bring back more moon rocks. This is a measuring device for seismic experiments on the moon that continued to function until the mid-1970s. And this is a laser reflector that continues to function today. That actually helps us measure the fact that the moon is receding from the Earth at several centimeters per year. So this site is where they landed. And if you've seen the movie First Man, you might be interested in looking at this shadow that you see along the way. This is the footsteps that Neil Armstrong left on the moon as he walked over to Little West Crater. This is where the movie producer indicates that he threw Karen's bracelet into the crater. Don't know if that's happened, but we do know that he did go out on an unscheduled trip to Little West Crater. And so the Russians were there too. We don't talk about this much, but the Russians had a robotic spacecraft in orbit around the moon. The first indication that Russia and the United States could cooperate with each other in space, even when they were yelling at each other on Earth, was the carefulness with which the Russian controllers kept their spacecraft from interfering in any way with the moon landing. It also is one bit of proof that the Russians know perfectly well that the landing did occur. There was a certain amount of chest pounding. Lyndon Johnson says, we can do anything. And, you know, hyperbolic, but much of the space program since has been fairly bold ideas that have been implemented by people that didn't want to be told they couldn't be done. There was also some hand-wringing. One article in the Times for the day after the landing reminded us that, you know, space war is possible. So we were worried about it 50 years ago. Worth keeping in mind that it's possible, but especially worth keeping in mind we've gone 50 years without it. And in spite of all sorts of nonsense on Earth, we've somehow managed to avoid it in space. Space war is possible. It's not inevitable. There was some irrational exuberance. We were going to have a lunar base, space laboratories, and a shuttle service within the next decade. Well, we didn't get the lunar base. The Russians had a space laboratory in orbit within a year. Salyut 1, we'll see a picture of that in just a minute. And the shuttle missed the 1970s by a couple of years. And it was to low Earth orbit and not to the moon, but still pretty impressive. Even a little amateur photography, I don't know how many of you were around at Apollo 11 time, but for weeks before the landing, there were instructions on how to take a picture of a television screen. Keep in mind that unlike the modern screens we're all comfortable with, this thing was scanning. So if you used the wrong shutter speed, all you got was lines of electron scan up the screen. So it was a non-trivial problem, and still a nice souvenir. So we end up with more things that happened afterwards. We had six more missions to the moon, including five landings and one mission that took people farther from Earth than any human beings have ever gone before or since. That was Apollo 13, set the all-time record for distance from Earth for human beings. The Russians were very active. The Salyut dimension of Venera 7 landed on Venus, actually transmitted data back from a planet whose surface was about 700 degrees Fahrenheit. Still the only country that successfully soft-landed on Venus. In spite of the hand-wringing, we had some detente in space. Apollo and Soyuz linked up in 75. The Russians and Americans even agreed on a common design for postage stamps. The Voyager spacecraft took advantage of the great alignment of planets to visit every planet then believed to be a planet except Pluto. Those two spacecraft have now left the solar system and are still transmitting data 42 years after they were built. That's a pretty good guarantee, actually. The space shuttle launched on April 13th, 1981, exactly 20 years after Gagarin's flight. And exactly 6 years after that, the International Space University is created, now having graduated 4,500 students in 100 countries. 100 countries back when Apollo existed, we had three or four involved in space. We've made several trips to Mars. Here are just a few samples of the successful ones. The space station ends up being one of the most dramatic engineering accomplishments of the human species, and now a pretty productive laboratory for material science and biomedical research. We've been to planets, little planets, dwarf planets, former planets, asteroids, comets. We currently have that far right, lower right. We have a mission at Juno, from which we'll hear a little bit more later, at Jupiter, the Juno mission. There's also been sort of a few missions to Earth orbit, about 2,500. I hope you'll forgive me for only sampling them here. But these missions have shown that space is also practical. It navigates for us, keeps time for us, helps us do medical research, does urban planning, deals with humanitarian relief. A whole host of functions, broadcast communications that have been extremely important. And it's even ushered in an era of commercial space flight that basically is characterized by private investment and risk capital. Some of these investments have led to the need for Cynda Collins-Arsenault's foundation to actually be dealing with access to space and space sustainability. And the Hubble Space Telescope not only is showing us amazing views of the universe, but it also represents cooperative activity. We went to the moon largely alone. One of the great accomplishments of recent times, most of the great accomplishments of recent times, have been joint missions. This one, a joint mission with the European Space Agency. Some of what we've done is just positively unbelievable. Well, maybe justifiably unbelievable. One of the things that Hubble has done for us as part of the Apollo legacy, is it shown that this is not all about hardware and engineering and science. It's also about perspective. It's about seeing things in ways we never dreamed possible. In seeing that there are insights to be gained from looking farther away and from different perspectives. This is a Hubble photograph. This picture, probably almost any great artist would have loved to have been able to sign this as a creative production. And yet, as you look at it, you can just see in the sort of the ridges of that photograph lines that are shockwaves. This is an explosion. gorgeous beyond belief, but also powerful beyond belief. And what Hubble has been able to show us is that there are parts of the universe that are unbelievably more active than this nice, quiet corner of the Milky Way galaxy that we happen to inhabit. And in fact, we can't yet see the Milky Way galaxy, but we can see galaxies we know to be very much like us. This one even has a companion galaxy like we do, the Great Magellanic Cloud, which is actually a little galaxy that's in our neighborhood. If this were the Milky Way, and it would look similar to this, we'd be hiding out around here, a nice quiet space in an otherwise hyper-energetic environment. And that would be good for us because we can only handle so much energy. We also get to places from which we can look back at Earth and see from perspectives you cannot have from Earth. This was taken by the Cassini spacecraft from behind Saturn relative to the sun. And that little dot with the arrow is us. So every problem you've ever had has been on that little white dot. That little white dot, planet Earth, in the solar system, it's the best place to be on a Friday afternoon. Now, some of the selfies have been taken closer to Earth. This taken by a receding spacecraft, a remarkable picture, the African continent, much of the Indian Ocean, just a beautiful image of Earth. If you really look hard around the edge of that image of Earth, you see just a little fuzziness. That's the air you're breathing. That's how thin this atmosphere is. And you can see it even more amazingly in this picture from the space station that shows us this very thin atmosphere. This black stuff is Earth. That's where we're living right now. This black stuff is nearly perfect vacuum, that's space. And this is all that separates us from certain death. Maybe we ought to take care of it. And so this perspective began in some ways in the Apollo era. We saw Earth rise and said, wow, Earth looks beautiful in space, but sort of small. We heard Buzz Aldrin come out of the lunar module and say, desolation, magnificent desolation. And we started to understand how different places could be in the universe. And so this is visual, but there's more than just visual in terms of the impact that we've been able to have with space. And so here's a video that reflects a little bit what Professor Comerford was saying to us last June when she was talking about how music had helped to explain gravitational waves. This is the use of music to explain why a planetary system known as TRAPPIST-1 with seven planets orbiting within 6 million miles of the sun in that system can hold together. It just violated everything we knew. But musical theory gave us a sense, and I think you'll enjoy seeing how this comes together. They're going to add one planet at a time with a different tone. This is the farthest planet, so it gets a deep tone. As the frequencies of the orbit get higher, that is more frequent, the notes get higher. But it's not random. These are the relationships of the orbits to each other by ratio, resonance in terms of music. Physics meets music theory. Then we're going to add percussion Each one of those cursors represents an alignment of planets. Alignments are gravitational events. Pretty good piece of drumming, actually. So what this helped us to understand was that the dynamics within this system were in perfect resonance with each other. That the alignments and the relative ratios, which were all interestingly whole number ratios, were such that the explanation for this system holding together was consistent with what we knew about music theory. It's enabled us to begin applying that theory to more and more situations, because you can't hear this in space, in a vacuum, but the basic laws of resonance appear to be governing celestial mechanics. Well, this can also inspire in the other direction. The group Vangelis actually produced a musical to go along with the time-lapse photography taken by the Juno spacecraft as it approached Jupiter, and for the first time showed us what the orbits of Jupiter's moons, four biggest moons, actually looked like. Now, before we start, you're seeing some of these dots here are the moons. This baby out here is probably Callisto. Here we're bright enough to maybe be Ganymede. These are called the Galilean moons, because Galileo was the first to realize they were orbiting Jupiter. But only in the last couple of years have we actually gotten the pictures that show us what this looks like. The first glimpse of harmonic motion. Part of what Apollo essentially did for us was inspired us to go look for things that were not easy to accomplish. And this, I guarantee you, was not easy to accomplish. What we have begun to see is a whole new perspective on what's going on in space. And we see that this is about inspiration. It inspires young people. I asked my granddaughter at one point, when she was playing with an American Girl doll in a spacesuit that some relative had bought her, whether she'd like to fly in space. And she said, yeah, I think so. Would you like to go to Mars if you knew it would take 2 years for the round trip and you would some for part of the trip be hundreds of millions of miles away from Earth? Some questions require more reflection than others. I don't think I've gotten an answer yet. But for my grandson, the response to the question I gave him was a little bit easier. I saw that he was watching a video inside this spaceship that some relative had bought him. And I asked him whether he thought he could have an iPad in space. And his response sort of tells you why this is the generation that's going to make it happen. He said, Daddy Doc, he said, why would anybody need all these dials and gauges if they have an iPad with connected to Wi-Fi? And so the inspiration is certainly great for kids. But I'll tell you, it's great for adults too. As this club knows better than anyone, I travel a lot. And as I think on the legacy of Apollo and everything we've done since that important landing, I think, you know, you can never quite tell where your next journey is going to take you. And so I'm prepared. I hope you enjoy tomorrow's anniversary, and I hope I've given you a little bit to think about. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
That's glad to answer questions.
Okay. We got about 5 minutes for questions. John Kotke, what a surprise.
Mike, this is fascinating. And as I was listening to you, the thing that kept, I mean, what Apollo did is just really kind of get our imaginations going in terms of, yeah, there are amazing things that are possible. I don't think Mike's lying. I don't know. But anyway, so my question to you as a scientist and as somebody who understands the space as much as can be understood, there's other intelligible life someplace in this vast universe?
Yeah, I mean, my answer is pretty simple, yes. The Hubble telescope actually spent several months of its existence looking at a spot of the night sky that's about the size of a dime. That's called the Deep Field Star Survey. In that Deep Field Star Survey, what we discovered were so many spots of light that were all galaxies. We now estimate that there are 100 billion galaxies, and that the average galaxy will house 100 billion stars. Now, I'm sure you've done the calculation in your head quickly, but that is 10 to the 22nd stars, and we haven't begun to get to the planets yet. And so the probability that in all of that mass of the universe, this is the only place where you can gather happily on a Friday afternoon, it just seems to be beyond credibility, more than seeing the Enterprise carried by a 747. So yes, I think there is somewhere out there. Maybe not as smart as us. That's scarier than that they're smarter than we are.
I wonder if you could comment on the advantages and disadvantages of manned space flights versus unmanned space flights, especially with the increase in artificial intelligence that we're encountering now.
Yeah, it's an interesting issue, and in fact, we often set it up as either or, when I think, frankly, the structure of future missions is going to be cooperation between robotic and human activity. Human beings obviously need a lot of life support. We don't do well in a lot of particular environments. But I've heard some of the great robotic scientists, including one who was responsible for the Spirit and Opportunity rovers on the moon, say, you know, the reality is that one well-trained field geologist could have done everything that Spirit did in the course of a weekend, okay? It would have taken a lot of work to get that field geologist there, but the reality is there's that trade-off. And artificial intelligence may play a role, but machine learning is still far enough away to not explain what we're going to do probably in the next 100 years or 200 years. But there's some very clever ideas out there. One is, why not make a trip to Mars where we send the astronauts to Phobos, a moon of Mars, much easier to land on than Mars, and have them drive robots from Phobos when they're only 20,000 miles away and the speed of light isn't an issue. Then we could do almost as much in a weekend as a field geologist. So machine-human collaboration is very likely the way the future will develop.
Mike, I'm the responder today, and I can only say, wow, what a wonderful presentation. We're so lucky to have you in our club to share with us these wonderful ideas and be such a fine storyteller. Particularly as a general semanticist studying, I was fascinated by your perspective, your comments about the different perspectives that are being understood. And one of the difference of perspective that is impressive has to do with just how countries at that time were cooperating with each other. I think we're very fortunate for that. When Gary asked me to make this response, I decided to pick up a book on anti-gravity, and I found that that the book was impossible to put down. After 26 years of arduous work, Rotary and its partners are on the brink of eradicating this disease. Anyway, it is conceivable for polio to be eradicated in the next few years. It is a window of opportunity of historic proportions as we move forward with the polio endgame strategy. If all we have fortitude to see this effort through to the end, then we will eradicate polio. So it's with so it gives me pleasure to give you this award for our speaker today,
Thanks a lot.
Sorry.